Hey guys, welcome to the beginner tutorial for breadboarding a guitar pedal. This is for beginners. We're going to start with a beginner circuit. A lot of people start with this circuit as their first circuit that they breadboard or that they build, which is based on a EHX, a Electro-Harmonix LPB1. We're going to be following my schematic purely for copyright reasons. I want to keep it sort of in-house, makes things a lot easier. And just going to make a couple of changes to my schematic to make it even simpler. And I'm just going to omit a couple of things. So let's have a look on the bench at the schematic, and I'll make the edits. I would recommend printing off the schematic, which you can get from my web store. You don't need to buy anything; it's just there. It's just a document you can download. Go to www.doitselfguitarpedals.com.au/shop. Then click on PCBs, and then click on the classic boost. So let me just show you that in action, just so it's easier for you to follow. PCBs and kits, and then classic boost, and then go down, 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 and then down here it says downloads, click on schematic, and print the schematic off. And this be, sound like a pirate saying that, and this be the amendments. Let's get rid of the tone control on the front, just so it makes life easier. So none of this you need to worry about. Just get rid of the input as well. And this 10 nanofarad capacitor we don't need to worry about. So the input is going to go off here. So we can just omit all of that, make it a lot easier for us. So that's not there, that connection's not there. So it's just straight into the base of the 2N5088. Whoops, which is off the screen. As you can see, goes into the 100 nanofarad capacitor on the input, and it goes through and then straight. That's more of a, that's closer to a Electro-Harmonix LPB1. I added that tone control as a mod to the input because there's not many boosts that have a tone control. I thought it might be something different to offer. And then this we can also get rid of. It's not important for a breadboard. It is reverse polarity in case you plug ground into plus and plus into ground. The diode will bypass the circuit, so you don't damage anything in the circuit. So we're just going to get rid of that as well. Everything else applies. So you're going to need two capacitors at 100 nanofarad each, a 1 meg resistor, a 100k resistor, a 10k resistor, a 560R resistor, and a transistor, which is a 2N5088. They're a dime a dozen. They're everywhere. You should be able to find it without much trouble. And also a 100k A being log. So when you see A, it means logarithmic, or log for short. Potentiometer, doesn't matter what size. This is just a test, obviously. If you want to make your effect smaller, then use a smaller pot when you actually solder everything up. I've just got a 16mm one here, which is fine. As you can see, it's got an A at the front, so it's log. So you could pause the video right here, open up a new window, and start the video from this point, and keep this in the background or on a separate monitor or something like that. So you can compare as we wire it up. You can have it on, if you've got two monitors, chuck this on one monitor and watch the rest of the video on the other. Or just print it off and make the edits as I've done. So, briefly how a breadboard works. I've hooked these up to my multimeter, which is in continuity mode, just to make this nice and simple. So it's just running straight into my multimeter off some banana to alligator clips, and then they go straight into these little cables. They just, that way I've got pins on the end, I can just shove them straight into the sockets. It's nice and easy to demonstrate. So up here, if we touch that one and this one together, well, firstly, continuity mode means if there's very low resistance, it will beep. So if I touch those two together, it will beep. Probably something like a ruler, which doesn't have much resistance, I reckon it would probably beep off that as well. There's a resistance point where it will stop beeping, as you can see. So basically, if there's a connection, it will beep. If there's no connection, it won't beep. So as you saw before, if I touch that, these are all connected together. Let's reposition the camera so we're looking straight down. It's a bit easier to follow. So these are connected, as you saw. I'd recommend you do this with your breadboard, because all breadboards are sometimes a little bit different. These are also connected, but these are not connected. The reason why they have a, well, the reason why I always thought they had a gap down the middle, see that channel that runs down the middle, and that they are not connected. Let me just plug them in and move my hands out of the way so you can see what the hell I'm doing there. So they're not connected, as you can see. Now, the reason why I always thought this channel was down the middle is for when you add an IC to the breadboard, you can just plug the IC straight in like this. The legs are not, if these rows were connected to these rows, then pin 1 would be connected to pin 8. Those two would be connected, those two would be connected. Wouldn't work very well. It'd be actually very difficult to, I can't think of a way that you'd actually be able to wire up an IC if you didn't have that down the middle. Let me get that IC out. It's in quite firmly. Took a bit of yanking, but I got it out. It's a new breadboard, so the connections are usually a little bit tight. These four are connected. Every row of four is connected, but they're not connected lengthways either, obviously, because otherwise you'd have a lot of connections going on. You'd have like 48 or however many there are there. So the only things that are connected are these, sorry, that's five. These five pins are connected together. These five pins are connected together. These five pins are connected together. They're not connected to the top part, etc., etc. And obviously none of these are connected to the top two sets of pins either. So this row is separated from this row, separated from this row, separated from that row. The only things are the five in each column or whatever it is. Those five, you get the idea. These are also connected, and this is important to know, because again, this can vary. I've seen a board that has been a bit different, which is probably not the norm. As you'll see, that whole, let me just pull that out because it's annoying, that whole row is connected the whole way along. So it's a ground point. So you'd put ground at one end and then you know that they're all connected. But when you go over that W and you go to the other half, they're not connected, because often you might want two separate grounds, or you might want two, you might have two separate power schemes going. So one half you'd use for one half of the power scheme and the other half you'd use for the other. So they keep that middle bit separate. But I have seen where that has been that connection has gone the whole way along that row. So just double check with yours, the way that I'm doing with your multimeter, and make sure. If that annoys you, of course, and I've actually done this, I actually did this on one of my other breadboards, you can just connect it together like that. So the whole thing is connected. You can have ground as that whole row, and you don't have to worry about, you know, if you're working your way down this end running wise back over to that half, you can just connect it there and then keep going across. So I hope that makes sense. Basic rundown of how the breadboard works. Let's start connecting up the Classic Boost. I think we should probably move on to that. This is a beginner tutorial, so I'm going into detail. That's just what I do. Some people like it, some people don't. I can't cater for everybody. I just do what I think people, I just explain things that I think people should know. So let's move on to the Classic Boost now. I've probably spoken enough about how the breadboard works and about breadboards in general, so let's move on. So the first thing to do is, I'm going to leave that connection there, so you might see me plug into one side or the other. The first thing I'm going to do is just plug plus and minus into here so I remember which is plus and minus, so red and black, and that I'm going to use these long ones for that. So off board I usually use the long ones, on board I'll try to use the solid core connections for those, just so it's neater so you can see what's happening. And I'm going to start at the start, which is the input. So I'm just going to start down here, pick any area, any arbitrary area on the board, and I'm grabbing a 100 nanofarad capacitor and I'm just going to whack it in here. So when I plug that into this random section of the board, you know now that the two leads are not, I have not made a short between those two leads. There's a gap. So because this leg is not connected to this one, the connections are only downwards, not across. And then we need to connect, if we look at the schematic again, I'll just pull it up for you so I can look at it as well. We need a 100K and a 1 meg resistor connecting to one side of that capacitor. Before I do that, let's assign the side that is the input. So I usually do input blue. It's personal preference. You can use whatever color you like. It's good to use a standard though, because it makes things easier to remember. So that side is going to be input. And again, I'm using one of these little cables with the pins on the end, because it's going off board. I need to connect an alligator clip to that later on. Makes it easy. This input is connected to the left side of the capacitor. So that pin that goes out of the capacitor is connected to this, which goes up to the input. Now on the other side, we need that 1 meg and 100K resistor, that is. It doesn't matter which way around you do this. When you think of a schematic, it doesn't matter about whether there's right angles here or how many little dots or connections you've made. Just as long as the pin from C1, one side of the 100K resistor, this side, one side of the 1 meg resistor, this side, and the base of the all connected together. It doesn't matter how you connect them together, just as long as they are connected together in that exact configuration. So let's go, I'm going to just bend those down. It's actually much neater if you cut the leads off, but I'm being lazy, so I'm just plugging it straight in. So just when you do plug it in, just pay attention to which connection hole you're plugging it into. Sometimes you might miss the one that you're actually aiming for. Might be easy if I actually put it slightly on an angle there so you can see what's going on. So that's the 100K resistor. 1 meg resistor is next. I'm just getting the components out of my drawers as I'm doing this and fold those down. And I'll go on the other side of the capacitor. So 1 meg, 1 meg. Now, I've actually made a mistake, you may have noticed, which is something I would have corrected. But you can see that I've connected those two ends of the resistor together. So effectively, on a schematic level, I've made a connection between this point and this point, which is not meant to be there. So it's easily fixed. Just pull one out and move it over one slot. So now they're separated like that. You can see that one leg is into the next row, so they're not touching anymore. So next I'm going to go from the, let me bring that back into shot, from the 1 meg resistor up to the 9 volt connection. So that was this connection up the top here to 9 volt. And then the other side of the 100K, whoops, the other side of the 100K goes to ground. It's quite hard to get the right size in the right hole. These are a little bit too close, so they're bending a bit. I've still got a solid connection though. So that's going to ground. So that is this one. And you can also, as you do it, sometimes I've done this in the past, I've ticked off the connections just to make sure, yes, that's connected, that's connected, that's connected, that's connected, that's connected. So let's get this transistor out of the way next, which is a 2N5088. If you get one of these with legs that are in line, obviously they're too close. So just bend them out a little bit. I'm going to actually just separate it from all the other stuff because it's going to get a bit too crowded over there. So I'm going to stick it over here, and then I'm going to run a jumper from the base back over to the first connection that we made. I'll show you this up close when I've done it just so you can see for yourself. So it's just like connect the dots, as you're seeing. So that goes back over to the original connection over there, and this is actually touching the emitter, not the collector. The base is the middle pin on the transistor. So you can see how I've connected that from the, let me get something to point. A pen will do. So it's going from the base, that's connected there, it goes across, which is connected to all that stuff that we mentioned before. Let's look at the schematic. 1 meg, 100K, and that side of the 100 nanofarad capacitor. So that is done. Now we need to connect the two resistors, that one and this one. So we might just do that. I usually go across the schematic like that. With something simple like this, it doesn't take up much room, so it doesn't matter so much. You don't need to do a hell of a lot of planning, which is really not what I'm doing at the moment. I'm just shoving stuff in a board. It tends to be the way that I do things. So yeah, we'll do the 100K next. So the pinout for the 2N5088 is emitter, base, collector. Emitter is the one that's usually connected to ground, and collector is usually the one that's connected to positive, or the most positive. So the 100K is connected to the collector. So the 100K needs to be connected to this pin here. The flat side, as you can see, is facing the camera, or facing me at the moment, facing the pen. So it's emitter, base, collector with the flat side in that orientation. So the 100K, sorry, so the 10K needs to connect to the collector. So shove him in there. This breadboard's a little tight because it's about the third time I've used it. Like that. And then the other side of the 100K needs to go to plus 9 volts. I'm just going to use one of these little cables for this one, because I don't have one that fits perfectly and it ends up just getting crushed like those two. So I'll go back to using that cable for that one. So the next one we'll do is the 560 ohm resistor. 560R means 560 ohm. 560 ohms. And that needs to go on the emitter to ground. Which you can cheat to. Another little thing that you can do is just plug the component straight into ground like that, so you don't need to add another connection. So let me just show you that close up. I've just gone straight from the emitter of the transistor over with the resistor, then down to ground. Makes things a bit easier to follow as well, because you have less jumpers and things flying around the place, but it's harder to modify now. You'll have to pull the resistor out and reconfigure everything if you want to add more components to that side of the resistor. But for this, doesn't really matter, because this is all we're going to be doing anyway. So that is that one. So if we look at the schematic again, we've done that side, we've done that side, we've done this side of the 10K resistor, and we've done this side. So now we are going into the 100 nanofarad capacitor, and that is connected to the collector of the emitter. Capacitors are usually short lead, so you can't really cheat like you do with the resistor. But I think I might be able to just plug it straight in there. So hopefully you can see that from the top. So the collector, which is the most right pin of the transistor, is connected to the capacitor lead on this side, and then the other lead on this side is connected to nothing. There's no other leads plugged into that row, so it's not connected to anything yet. But we're going to do that next. So that's this side done. So now on this side, we need to connect that to pin 3 of the potentiometer. Which one is pin 3? So pin 3 on the potentiometer is this one. So when the dial, it's nice and easy to remember, because when the dial is facing you, like I'm holding it now, you just count in order, 1, 2, 3. So the yellow, this one here, the yellow wire will be connected to the other side of that 100 nanofarad capacitor, which is in the background there. So it's actually going to connect, if I line that up, to that hole or any of those holes that's connected to that side of the capacitor, which I'll do right now. Pin 1 on the potentiometer is connected to ground. So the other side of the potentiometer, which will be the orange lead, pin 1, is connected to ground. So that's easy enough. We just plug that straight in. We don't need to make any other connections, because we've got this little harness thing going on. And then the middle pin, which is pin 2, the middle pin on the potentiometer, is the output. So you don't need to connect that to anything. That is your output. That's what will connect to the amp when we're testing it. So I'm just going to bend those legs out, kind of destroying the potentiometer doing that, but it's going to be easier for you to see. So the potentiometer will just have to be sacrificed. I don't like doing this, wouldn't recommend it. blue tacking it to the breadboard. I'll try and pick a spot that doesn't have too many pins and not push down too hard, because you get blue tack stuck in the holes. So what we need now to test the board is, to test the effect, is four connections. And often when you build a guitar pedal, you'll always end up with these four external connections. Input, plus 9 volts, ground, which are all connected together, all those grounds are connected together, and an output. So the power, plus, minus, your input signal and your output signal. Kind of makes sense when you think about it that way. You need something to power the thing. You need sound, input sound, and you need output sound, which is exactly what we've got. The middle pin of the potentiometer, pin 2, the input, plus and minus. So how do you connect this spiderweb of cables to your amp? Well, that is the next part of the video. So just a couple of details before we move on to testing the effect that I wanted to talk about first, is if we didn't put that potentiometer in and we put our output directly off that C3, 100 nanofarad capacitor on the output, we would get maximum volume out of the circuit. And if you want to do that, you can do that, but be warned, it will be very loud. So your amp will cop it pretty bad. So just be careful. If you're going to do that, you want to leave off the potentiometer on the output. You're going to get significant boost on the output. Warning. I'm just mentioning this because I thought you might be interested to know that that volume is to lower, it lowers the output volume from here. It doesn't increase the output volume from here. It lowers, it's a resistor. It lowers the voltage from on the output. So yeah, that's just basically how that potentiometer works in a very basic sense. You're going to need three things for this: a power source. Whoops, where's it gone? A power source. I'm using a miniature DC jack from my website, the economy one. It doesn't matter; they're both the same as they're pretty much the same as the Lumberg ones as well. And I'm using two of my low-profile jacks. Again, I'm not trying to sell you something. This is what I have on hand these days. It's what I use all the time. They're the mini mono jacks, but you can use any mono jack that you have that's the same sort of thing. So you need those three, and you'll need obviously a power source. So just a typical, let me grab it, typical power supply. This is the one that I made. It's just a regulator, and you plug your power in as you normally do. So we're going to plug the power into the DC jack like this. And then I'll put alligator clips on the plus and the minus. The big one's a plus, the little one's a minus. I've already covered those. And some alligator clips. Now, one thing that I've been thinking of is, what if I've actually wired this up incorrectly? Well, you'll know that you've wired it up incorrectly, or that I've wired it up incorrectly, because it won't work. So it may not work. I haven't even checked over. It's a good idea to actually double check your effect before you even bother plugging it into the amp, but I'm in a bit of a hurry and I'm doing this behind a video as well, so it's even more confusing for me. I've got so many things going on, but we'll plug it in, see if it doesn't work, and if it doesn't work, I'll work out the problem and I'll tell you what it is. So let's give it a crack. So how do we wire this thing up? Well, we're just going to follow this schematic, and I've done this on my YouTube channel about 50 times, but I'm going to do it again because I want to make this breadboard tutorial complete instead of just making it eye candy, so that you can watch and go, wow, that was great, but I didn't actually learn anything. So let's just go yellow on the input, blue, and then on the jack, you'll see one is connected to this little pin. That's the tip, that's your signal. This shield is ground. And that's connected to this little lug here. You can see physically that it's actually connected. And you can also see physically that that lug is connected to the tip contact. So your alligator clip will go on that lug for the input. And you'll need a ground to go to the other lug, which is connected to the shield, the one that was on the other side. I really do need some new alligator clips. That one is absolutely hammered. Looks like it's been through hell and back. So that goes like that. And I'm just following this schematic, as you can see. Where's the input? That's the input. Sorry, it didn't come off on the print off, but that is the input. Tip, ground, goes to the sleeve. What's ring? Why have I got ring on there? Ring is for a stereo jack. You don't need a stereo jack. You can use a mono jack. Just connect the ground, the negative from the battery to sleeve, and the ground to sleeve, and omit the ring altogether. So let's do the output next, and it's the same thing as what we just did. So we go from the output over here. So that's the middle pin, the middle lug of the potentiometer, and that goes to the tip contact, like we just did with the input. Connect that to there. Connect ground to ground. So you can just connect this to the any point, any contact that you can touch. That you can make a connection with along the ground. So as you can see, I'm doing black for ground just to make it a little bit simpler. So that goes to ground again. Ground is kind of like, it's just a network of connections. It doesn't matter where along the ground you connect it to or how, it just has to connect to ground. It's kind of like the waste for your sewage. It all the water, the taps, the sinks, the toilet, everything connects to the sewage pipe at the back of your house, and it takes it all away. It's, if you sort of think of it like that. So what have we got left? We've got plus. So these two connections will be made now to the DC jack, which I just showed you before. So, well, let's do minus first, because I've got a white one, and generally I use white for negative. So again, doesn't matter where, just got to connect to the ground, to ground somewhere. And again, that says battery, but it's the same thing as a DC. You can do it the same. Just make sure you don't short those two together, because you'll probably get a zap. Maybe my DC is not connected. I have to check if it's plugged in at the wall. Usually you get a zap. Okay, so that goes to the plus. And as you can see, it's getting messy. It tends to get messy at this point, because you start making connections on connections on connections. And that is also why, don't be upset if it doesn't work when you plug it in. You've got a lot of things going on, even for a basic circuit like this. You've probably made a mistake. You've just got to go over it systematically and check it all. But when you hear the boost working, you won't be able to remove the smile on your face for about half an hour. Let me just check the power. So now it's just a matter of plugging your guitar in. Make sure you put your output in your output and your input in your input. It's a common mistake to put your input into the output and the output in the input, and then you get nothing. Whoops, sorry, my guitar cable. You get nothing on the output, and you go, oh my God, what's wrong with it? There's actually nothing wrong with the circuit. You've just plugged the connections in the wrong way. I've done that many times. And also remember that you might have your volume turned down completely, so you might not get anything on the output. Turn your amp on very low before you do anything. I've got my amp on nothing. Actually, it's in standby at the moment, but the volume is on zero, because I'm going to slowly turn it up so I don't deafen myself. There is sound, that's good. And the volume control works. That's actually full volume. And that's obviously minimum, so it's all working. Yours works too. If it doesn't, like I said, go over everything, go over all the connections you've made on the breadboard, and go over your connections with your alligator clips. You may be intimidated to use a multimeter, but I would suggest it. And just check the basics, check that ground is 0 volts, check that 9 volts is 9 volts, and make sure you can even do continuity mode, and just make sure that the connections are made in between those points that we were ticking off. And that they're not connecting to anything else. And just visually check it over, make sure that it's working properly, because you'll probably find, oh, I connected that to the wrong spot, or one of the legs on the breadboard actually isn't lined up properly and it's just floating, etc., etc. So what can you do now? Well, you can, of course, modify the circuit. You could add a tone control like I did. You can
you can actually add that tone control to the front of the circuit. You could change the 560 ohm resistor on the emitter. Generally, the emitter resistor has an effect on the gain, the biasing of the circuit, and the general gain of the circuit. So you could play around with that. Lowering it increases the gain. Always forget that. And increasing it lowers the gain. So you could change that to a potentiometer, a 1K potentiometer, and play with that and see. Then you can see when you make that modification with a potentiometer, you can see exactly what happens when you turn the dial when you're increasing the resistance, as opposed to turning your amp off, changing the component, turning your amp on again, and then forgetting what the actual sound sounds like. There are tons of things. Change a transistor, put a lower gain transistor in it, put a higher gain transistor in it, put a Darlington transistor in it. Whew! Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this. I hope I've inspired you to pick up a breadboard and give it a shot. It's probably one of the most, it's one of the most time-consuming and potentially frustrating parts of electronics in my experience, but it is by far the most rewarding one. And isn't that just life summed up right there? The hard parts are usually the rewarding parts. For those people that have children will know exactly what I'm talking about. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, give me a thumbs up. I hope you got a working effect. If you've got questions, leave them in the comments. I try and answer questions as best as I can. Other people might help you out as well. Other visitors to the video might respond to your questions as well. Thank you very much. Enjoy breadboarding. Cheers, guys.